Anyway, so welcome. Thanks for coming. This is the first panel, which is not being run by me, although I'll be sitting there. So I'm going to introduce Bob Alotta from the Astraea Foundation, who's going to take over as moderator.
So the first takeover of the day has started. That's good. Mm-hmm. I am Bob Alotta, and I'm really excited to be talking to these two brilliant folks. So why don't we, I'm assuming you've memorized everyone's bios, but why don't just a quick tell us what you would like anyone in the room to know about yourselves. Matt?
Hey, I'm Matt Mitchell. Thank you for waking up so early, getting online, and coming out here.
He doesn't realize this is the second session of the day, and we didn't have the first because we knew we didn't want to wake up early.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. I saw those people. I'm Matt Mitchell. I'm a hacker. I'm the director of digital safety and privacy at an organization called Tactical Tech. They're a Berlin-based NGO that works on privacy stuff. And I also do a project called Crypto Harlem, which is teaching folks in the inner city about circumvention technologies to circumvent surveillance, and about cryptography and, you know, basics of privacy stuff.
What year was your first PGP key party?
We had that, like, I don't know, maybe it was like 6-7 years ago. We had a DJ though, so was, you don't, where's the last time you had a key signing with a DJ? So, you know, we like to do a little bit different uptown in New York City.
Hey, I'm Bruce Schneier. I'm assuming everybody knows me.
We should all just make that assumption about ourselves, I think.
Bruce is a force.
And I am Bob Alotta. I run the Astraea Foundation. We fund LGBTQI activism around the world, and we also bring technologists and human rights defenders together and try to, A, queer technology, and B, really look at what security looks like for communities who are often under the threat of violence or in permanently insecure situations. So let's start off, whether this is or isn't early in the morning for you. Why are we having a conversation about public interest technology? What does it mean in this space?
Well, you know, there is this thing called like public interest law, and everyone knows that there's law firms that do pro bono work, and there are people who will be out there to assist you, whether it's working as like a public defender, et cetera, right? But in the technology space, if you meet someone who's a young technologist, who's a prodigy, people think, oh, you should go work for some tech firm, right? There's not this other path where you can give service to the state and the people and the governance around you, whether or give service to nonprofits or civil society or people who are trying to act for the public good and benefit. And there's a role there, there's a path there, and you don't have to be, you know, sleeping in your grandpa's basement when you're doing this work. You can find it to be rewarding with amazing challenges. You could be finding it to be economically rewarding. It's just a path that a lot of people don't consider or realize. And I think it's great that we're all coming together to explain how, in big and small ways, whether you're still working your 9-to-5 or like 10-to-11 job or whatever it is, if you work in cyber, and you can still give back, or you can take a sabbatical or change your whole career path. Because this is like the only work that I do.
So I think it's sort of past time we as an industry stepped up to the policy implications of what we do. Now, there's a pervasive myth in Silicon Valley that tech is neutral, that tech has its own force, that tech is what it is, and we have to accept it. It's kind of never been true, but we've been allowed to pretend it's true, largely because what we did didn't matter. I mean, really, it's okay for tech people to build whatever world they see fit, if we're just, you know, using news groups to talk about Star Trek. And that's really how the internet was created. And now it does matter. I mean, we kind of knew that in our field, that the work we did had social implications. But what's going on now with, you know, Russian propaganda, with Facebook and Facebook influence, cybersecurity, the Internet of Things, and stuff that will actually kill you, that the social implications of our work has never been more obvious to everybody. It's not just we who realize it, everybody realizes. So policy is coming to our industry, whether we like it or not. Right? The libertarian playground we've been allowed to have is just not going to stand. So I think it's incumbent on us to help this process. I mean, otherwise, policy will be done to us by legislatures who wonder how Facebook makes money. And that's going to happen unless we make for a better outcome. So I think we need to understand the policy implications of our work. We need to get involved in the policy of our work to different degrees, right? Whether it's actually taking tech and using it for public interest purposes or doing direct policy work, somewhere in between, right? In these decades, our industry is going to become critical to the health of society. And it's just, we can no longer sit back and say, you know, tech is tech. Policy is policy. They're kind of separate. Because they're not.
I mean, it's provocative to think like this sort of utopian, I'm going to step away from the realities of my body in a way, right? It's this, mm-hmm. this disembodied proposition and then the implication of what it means for people in that way. I mean, what's your... let's take what Bruce is saying. What's your point of entry there? You know, mm-hmm. what's the provocation for you to walk through that door?
Well, for me, you know, I happen to be black, right? That's a newsflash. And, you know, technology...
I'll alert the media.
Yes. Thank you, Bruce. Put that on the headlines of the Register. So, yeah, I mean, technology is good and bad, right? Like, you always hear, like, technology could be nuclear power that, like, you know, operates a city for pennies, or a nuclear bomb that decimates the planet, right? So, but for people of color, for queer folks, for any marginalized group, the negatives of technology are often felt. So for me, it's more of like a self-defense. My provocation comes from like self-preservation. And a lot of folks don't realize that, you know, we all talk about surveillance being not a good thing and how it can infringe on people's privacy. But there's some of us where the surveillance is all around us in our communities, in our country, in our state. Depending on your passport, you know, you might find that your technology is something that happens to you, something technology that leaves a bad taste in your mouth or harms you in a certain way. And I've always felt like it's something that I want to do is educate folks about the technology around them, especially when it has a negative impact on themselves and their communities. And whether that's getting on a plane and working with human rights defenders, you know, in like an African country or in Southeast Asia or anywhere, and trying to safeguard them. So it's something that I take very seriously. You know, I always say like the number one targeted group on the internet is anyone who self-identifies as a woman, right? So, you know, in this room, regardless of who you are and whatever identity that you hold dear, and you claim for yourself, there's gonna be a negative impact the technology has on you. And I'm a big fan of technology. I've always been a hacker and a geek, and I think technology is beautiful and wonderful and only should be opening doors and making things pleasant. And for a lot of people, technology is thunderstorms and a rainy day. And public interest tech is something that will be there to safeguard you and take care of you, and that's my entry point.
You know, and I think we feel this in our industry. I mean, so much of what we do is, you know, the military term is dual use. And we build tools that do good in one hand and can do bad in the other. It's the same tool. And we've been struggling with that, you know, pretty much since the beginning. Whether we are building tools that, right, the same tools we use in corporations to prevent data leakage is being used to track dissidents in other countries. So we really have to wrestle with this in ways that I think we tend to ignore. Now, I think the power imbalance is real important. That when we build tools, we build tools of empowerment. And a lot of question is, who is being empowered? Right? Are individuals being empowered, or are the already powerful being empowered? And we can tweak things. We can build tools where it's more likely that the people being empowered are individuals. And are marginalized people, are people in countries that don't have a lot of power. Or we can build tools that empower those who are already powerful, making them more powerful. And these issues are hard. And I think things that, you know, if we think about it, we're gonna wrestle with for a long time. And so I tend to think more abstractly, mm-hmm. I mean, less on the ground and more about these dynamic flows
of power and how technology affects those.
So if we stay there, what would push someone past being agnostic, right? Is being agnostic possible at this juncture? Do you think that that can happen?
I think most people are agnostic. I think people are agnostic because they just don't think about it. Right? We go to work and we build what we're building, mm-hmm. and it's not that we don't care how things are being used. It's that, you know, that's not our job. Our job is to create. Our job is to code. Our job is to design, and we design these tech tools, and sort of someone else handles mm-hmm. the use cases, and that's easy. And because every day, you know, we're not going to see how a tool might affect a person. But, you know, I think what's happening now in the media is that the effects are becoming national news. Mm-hmm. I mean, right, Mark Zuckerberg made an enormous announcement yesterday. Now, it's hard to know if we'll take him seriously or not, on sort of changing how Facebook views privacy, mm-hmm. probably because he's looking at the world and saying, I did this? That wasn't my plan. Mm-hmm. Because it's easy not to have a plan. So I think agnostic is default. And I think it's, I mean, I'd like to push against that and say that people can no longer be agnostic. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not making munitions, but we kind of are. So maybe the ITAR was right in the 70s, which is kind of scary. I didn't mean that seriously.
Okay. So, and, you know, for me, I feel... You know, I was a developer. I used to go to work and just like build stuff and just write code, and that was exciting, and those were challenges there. But more and more what you're finding is the code that you're writing is being used to harm people, right? Mm-hmm. And we all like point to, well, like the heads of these tech firms, which all tend to be people who have the same passport and tend to look pretty much the same, right? But each company is made up of human beings. Like, there's no like AI robot building the things that you're interfacing with. There's someone there who had to go to the bathroom and take a break and eat lunch and things like that. And the things that shake you from being agnostic is, one, when you're directly affected by these things, right? When you realize that it's hurting women, or it's hurting queer folk, or it's hurting people of color, and they're not just it's not just a name or a group, but it's an individual you know, right? Or when you read the headlines and you're like, wait, there's genocide in Myanmar, and is there blood on my keyboard? Right? Did I passively or in any way create that harm? And I would argue that if you're not doing something, and that something could be rather small, right, then you are creating harm. There's a certain byproduct of the tech that we love and that we do, and that byproduct is radioactive and dangerous, and in many parts of this world, fatal. And so, you know, I think that it's something that we no longer can say, oh, I didn't realize, I was just following orders, I was just doing what my project manager told me, et cetera. I'm just love that app, I just installed it and used it. We all are playing a role in creating a negative waste product. And now it's about balancing our footprint and doing some positive. You don't have to change your life and do this all day. That's gonna impact everything positively.
Yeah, and this is a surprise from last year that employees at tech firms have a lot of power, right? Even if we have these large monopoly companies that don't answer to their consumers or users who aren't their consumers, they answer their employees. All these firms are competing for the same talent pool. They are competing for us. And we saw last year, Google employees basically rise up and say, we are not gonna work on this DoD AI visualization project. We're not gonna work on Project Maven. Mm-hmm. And the company acquiesced, because the employees have an enormous amount of power. Google loses, you know, 5% of their employees. That's a freaking disaster. And so we as tech employees have an enormous amount of power to shape how technology works that we're not using.
And I would say that history will judge us. We'll look back and, you know, this isn't like any normal time. Right? I like to use this like golden hour of like emergency first aid. Like, we have a certain window here to change the trajectory of how things will move forward. And next couple of generations will look back and be like, why didn't you do anything? Like Manhattan Project type questions to us. So now is the time to take off our blinders and just kind of see things for what they are. And I'm really proud of people like those Google employees. This year, Microsoft employees with their open letter trying to say they don't want to work on HoloLens. They don't want to work on military weapons. They were here to excite and delight people with technology and their abilities, not to kill and hurt people.
I think you're both bringing up something, two points that I think are really interesting. Also, I'm warning you now that we're going to open up to questions. So good morning again, and start thinking about what those questions might be. But the two things that you both brought up that I think are important. It seems like there's this it's this moment between passivity and power, right? And so that, and this idea, does it have to be all or nothing? And I'm hearing you saying it actually, it's steps. It doesn't have to be all or nothing, right? You're not necessarily throwing in the towel, but taking a stand is actually can create a power shift. And how we're just conscious of the work that we're doing, just that level of passivity makes us have to make some choices. So I think that that's a really interesting point, just in terms of, so maybe it's degrees of wokeness I'm talking about, right? So I'm willing to actually know that this has an implication. And it may not have to be an implication that's a million miles away, that I'm actually in a position to do this work and I need a particular balance of democracy in order to do it. And that I'm willing to participate in that balance to have democracy. And then I'm already participating, it's whether I'm willing to know. Mm-hmm. So what are there, you mentioned policy, but maybe we could get a little weedsy, like is there any particular policy or issues around data or things that you see that are happening right now that we should be conscious of or thoughtful about?
We know our issues, right? Going dark, the government access to encrypted data is still an issue, right? We had the FBI director 2 days ago on stage at this conference talking about, trying to scare people with what is his phrase, the massive ungoverned space where, I don't know, everybody, it makes no sense to me, but this notion that cryptography is harmful to democracies. We have a new law in Australia. It's happening in the UK. And I think that will continue to be an issue. We are certainly Internet of Things, ranging from small consumer goods to the national power grid, how we secure that and the policy implications of that. Surveillance capitalism and the limitations, I think, will increasingly become an issue, especially as it intermeshes with government uses of surveillance, both in countries like China and countries like the U.S. Propaganda and how social networking platforms are used to harm, I think will be a huge issue. And a lot of this stuff, the last one, of course, is supply chain. And we're seeing a lot of talk last year about supply chain security and 5G. This 5G is coming, and will it be a network that forces security or surveillance? And these are actually all real problems with real tech that has to be solved. And if we're going to solve supply chain security, that's going to require us to do a lot of work. Mm-hmm. But we're going to need to recognize, some of the policy implications. I mean, if 5G is being built for surveillance because countries like the U.S. like it, it's going to be hard for us to stop countries like China from using it for surveillance. And we sort of have to decide. And I want us to inform these policy debates. That when these policy debates happen without tech input, we get really bad policy. So those are some of the things I think that are coming in our space. You broaden the definition of security, and we're still working about algorithmic fairness, adversarial machine learning, all the things around AI and automated decision making that will affect us. And the issues coming for us down the pike are going to be there. And we actually have a lot to do here. These are our problems are not going away.
Mm-hmm. Did you want to speak to that?
I'm a hacker, so I love the policy people. Thank you for the work that you do. I don't put much faith in rules. I'm more about the power of the people with the keyboards. Mm-hmm. And I feel that at Tactical Tech we have this like data detox kit. It's like you just go online, download this thing, and it's like ways for you as a regular person to like create less data and be less dependent on these tech firms and on these harmful entities. So I really feel that there's more of us, people who love technology, love the internet, than, and we have to, we have to be the ones that are going to watch C-SPAN. We have to be the ones that are going to stay on top of the issues. You can do a lot to educate people through your social media, through your friends, through your physical form. You know, getting to know the people at the table sitting with you and what brought them to RSA and what brought them to this room might bring more positive change than, you know, writing a letter or trying to put pressure on a conflicted political entity. So,
I mean, I think that when you were speaking, Bruce, I was thinking about and what that keynote might have been indicating. There's a way that who's prioritizing whose privacy, right? And also, how do we become criminalized? And you talked about, well, I'm going to walk into this room with a presumption of some kind of forced criminality, if the way that this data works, the way that surveillance works. And then the implications around headlines are that, oh, more of us could become criminalized. More of us could lose a sense of privacy. And what's the relationship to privacy and democracy? What's the relationship? I'm curious about the relationship between physical and digital security, right? And sometimes when that insecurity is so close together, then you have this imperative to work on these issues. And when your digital and physical security feel really far apart, personally, unless it's an ethical issue, then you don't necessarily feel. And I think that you know, we talk a little doomsday-ish, I think, many of us, about this moment, but it's also this very beautiful moment around consciousness, I think, about that more and more people don't need that personal, necessarily, that personal coming together or see between digital and physical insecurity to actually care about their relationship between their own passivity and power.
And they're very related. I mean, we saw this new story, I guess, in the past month that phone companies are selling location information to bounty hunters. Right? It's very much, this is all about digital security, but it's increasingly about physical security. Right? Just because it knows where you are and who you associate with and what you're doing. And it's very hard to separate the two now. That increasingly the way physical security is violated, at least to start, is through digital means. The use of the internet for stalking, the use of the internet by mostly men to abuse their spouses. These are real problems that we have to address. And to get back to the beginning, this is all again about power. Mm-hmm. Right? Who are we empowering? How are we empowering them? And is that power being used for good or for bad?
Mm-hmm. There's an opportunity for kinship, right? Like, I also think that that's actually something that we can be thoughtful about, right? Like, so as people of color, as queer people, like, we have a kinship kind of walking in the door, right? But then what does it mean to also have a kinship around, we have a skill set, we work in a sector, we have the ability to see and impress difference in a particular kind of way, and that how do we make these choices around the work that we're doing to actually broaden our spheres of kinship, to proffer things that we believe in, or at least stay back the things we don't believe in. And I think that that's actually a really different kind of word that then necessarily gets brought into tech spaces. And I think there's a way, though, it surely, at the very least, makes your day better, right? If you get to be in that kind of a relationship or in that kind of relationship. So I think, that really comes to mind when you're both talking about policy or even hacking spaces, right, to make them more livable for more of us. How are we doing? Does anybody come close to having a question? Are there any questions?
So there are two microphones. There's one there and one there. Because we're recording this, we'd like you to stand up go to the microphone.
Yeah, so if you can line up at the microphones. You see that thing is happening where there's that empty microphone there.
Yeah. They just opened up another aisle. Miles through over there.
Yeah.
Express grocery.
The price is right.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Come on down.
Right on. Okay, let's start here. Would you mind saying your name?
I don't.
And if you do, that's totally okay.
Yeah.
It's Martin. Or the guy with the unicorn on his head, either one.
Right on.
So my view is the technology is neutral. However, use exaggerates the bias of the user. I think that's what I'm seeing, is use exaggerates the bias of the user. Like the whole thing with iPhones and face unlock, not being able to unlock certain types of faces because there was a bias introduced into the software towards the people who developed it. With that kind of as a backdrop, do you feel that policy, shouldn't it be like the last bastion when social norms don't adequately ensure equanimity? Or shouldn't social norms be what makes sure that people are treated appropriately? Shouldn't it offend, because that's what I kind of hear Matt saying especially, it should offend me that my neighbor is not being treated properly. And that's not really policy, right? So policy to me is somebody's coming in and saying, you people aren't acting appropriately. We're going to tell you how to act. And that's, it's really hard to enforce, right? Policy is the one control that you can't make a user do or make someone act. You can't make them do it. You're just going to say, here's our guidelines. Social norms, I think, are much more powerful. And so thoughts on that.
Right. So, this was a topic of one of my books on Liars and Outliers. And social norms go a long way. Right? I mean, there's enormous number of social norms going on in this room. That's ensuring that not only you are all sitting quietly, standing in line, but you're not leaping up and attacking the person next to you. I mean, there's a lot going on here on how we are supposed to act. And we're all doing it. Social norms work most of the time. When we get to technologies that can do large amounts of harm, I don't have to worry about like the Four Sigma guy or the Three Sigma guy, that social norms might work for most of us, but it won't work for the very small minority of us that won't follow those social norms. So I don't think of policy as a last resort. I think of it as one of the things that we need to do, right? We need social norms. We need laws, we need tech, right? The social norm against hacking into a bank and stealing the money, right, will work great for pretty much everybody on the planet, right? We're not gonna do it because that would be wrong. But for the rest of us, you kinda need laws, and for the people who don't care about those, you kinda need firewalls and stuff. So I think as security people, we recognize, we work in that area where social norms aren't enough. And we know that.
Mm-hmm. And I would say I do believe that it's on us and good intentions are important, but sometimes good intentions go astray and they create harm that we didn't realize. So yeah, I mean, we do need to have those social norms. We do need to think about our neighbors, especially those neighbors who tend to be targeted more than the rest of us, et cetera. But if you look at things like the use of WhatsApp to entice violence in places like Southeast Asia, right? You know, people say like, okay, mob violence was, you know, created on WhatsApp. And one, people shouldn't be attacking their neighbors. They shouldn't see this misinformation, fake news, and form these gangs, right? But two, one of the ways that Facebook fixed it or tried to mitigate that harm was they limited the number of forwards you can have on WhatsApp, because now you only can forward to a few people, and it actually worked. And so we need, one, the individual to look out for those around them. We also need the tech firm to ask, could anyone use this to do bad things? Because that's not usually in that life cycle when you're working on your product. It's not in your roadmap. And then three, right, we need the laws. We need, and I am one who's like, I'm allergic to those policy discussions, but they're super important, like Bruce said. So, and I think when they come together, then we have a really beautiful use of tech. Thank you, Martin.
So just a quick follow-up question, because you both.
So there's a bunch of people behind you, so let's not.
Yeah. But you can read, we're available to you outside afterwards. Okay. I want to keep talking about this. Thank you, Martin.
Let's go to that microphone.
Hi, Duncan Sparrow, hacker handle, sfractal. I'm an old retired guy. I'm not a rock star like you guys. I'm more at the lounge singer, maybe down at the karaoke level. And
wait till you see us after 7.
And I have heard Matt talk before, and I love his digital kit, and that's something I can do as an individual, but I don't work at Google. I don't work at whatever. I do have some free time. I am interested. I do bug my congressman on all these issues and stuff like that, although just switched, and I got to learn a whole new set of aids and stuff like that. But on the big picture issues that you mentioned, Bruce, what can I do? Is there anything I can do? Or is that just a, it's going to have to be death by a thousand cuts. I don't know. I've been actually consciously trying to figure out things to help, and it's hard. There's fellowships you can apply for if I felt like working full time. I don't want to work full time. I'm retired. I'm having fun. What little things can you do if you're not the rock stars doing this?
I struggle with this, right? And I think that the things we can do as individuals are more at the grassroots level that you can better answer. Because what you're doing is affecting individuals, changing how they think, changing how they view technology, society. And that is kind of a grassroots change, but it makes a huge change. So I look to you as what can someone who's, you know, knowledgeable, retired, has some time, what can they do?
And I would say you'd be amazed that in a lot of rooms, you are a rock star. Because you are, it's like that, like a local stage, kind of like, you know, cool concert hall. You are a rock star in that space. And when you walk in that space, you have a localization, a familiarity with the context that everyone sees themselves in you. And you can say, listen, I use this, this is why. So as computer people, there's not a lot of physical contact in our lives, right? I'll be the first to admit that. But maybe you're like, well, I do eat groceries and I do go to this place. I don't have that delivered to my home. Or I do have a library near me. And those places, you just sit down and you hand out some flyers and you're like, look, once a month, first Mondays, I'm here if anyone wants to have coffee. And that's how I started Crypto Harlem, and it became huge. So, you know, if you want to speak at an elementary school or a junior high school or a high school, they would love to have you. You are the biggest rock star ever there. You're Freddie Mercury there, okay? So, you know, I would say that in different parts of our lives, whether it's in our community center, if you're a person of faith, you might have a place you go, or in those spaces, that's where you're having the biggest impact, and a place where I wouldn't be able to walk, you would walk in there and everyone be like, who's this guy, right? So I would say find that space and experiment. You'll see that you represent other people who are like, I'm so thankful that you came out here and did this.
I want to uplift the three prongs that got brought up in the last question, and I think it really does speak to what Matt just said in response to you, right? This idea of policy, of tech, and then society, right? But that we all have our own ecosystem, and I think that that is a really, it eliminates, I think, this anxiety of some ultimate endeavor, right? That if we really honor that we each are operating inside of an ecosystem, it's how laws, the disparity between laws and lived experience, right? We get to create the lived experience, whether there is a law or not. And I think oftentimes there's laws and there's still a vastly different lived experience, right? For different ones of us. So I think that that actually, like, owning our ecosystem and working as locally as possible it's really rewarding, but also the impact, if we can really honor that impact, more of us, I think, would step forward. I'm really glad you asked that question.
Thank you.
Hey, my name is Catherine, or KK. So my question is about polarization and stratification. So you mentioned the Google and Microsoft protesting military uses. So a little bit about me. I went to Barnard in New York City. I protested the Iraq War. Like, I was at the forefront of social movement and protest. I graduated. Barbara Ehrenreich was my commencement speaker. Like, she's talked about Abu Ghraib. And she talked about the reason that happened was because there was not a voice, right, in that cellar. And that's what happened. So I joined the Army Reserves. And I've been, fast forward 15 years, I work for the Navy. I'm at the forefront of, you know, naval warfare, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm also an Army reservist. So another side of that story, right, is the fact that there's someone using those glasses, right? And that person could be making mistakes, but there's also the chance that he could be killing, or she could be looking for insurgents who are using deep fakes to create fundamentalist worlds, right? So it's him or the soldier at that point. So my question is, how do we carve a door within that wall, right? Is that even possible? And then, like, how do we make sure public interest doesn't become an echo chamber? Like, how do we broaden these fears of kinship, right? Because I'm struggling right there with you. Like, why I'm in this field, there's room for us together, but how do we do that? So, thanks.
Thanks, KK.
So I think this is hard. I mean, I'm not convinced that the Project Maven decision was the correct one. I mean, I like that Google employees had power, But I thought that was a very complex issue. And to say that we shouldn't work on that, I didn't know enough to know that. So I think we do have to build these doors between government military uses and sort of our uses. We have a problem that we had a very, there's a lot of mistrust right now between the tech community, especially in security, and the government. And that's because of government actions revealed by Edward Snowden, government actions revealed in other ways. So we are understandably skittish when the government says, you know, we're using this for good. But, you know, we also have to recognize that we have a military, we have a police for good reasons. Right? And we want the police to be able to solve crimes. And our goal in end-to-end encryption is not to make it so the police can't solve crimes. We recognize that processes like a warrant are there as security measures when we give the police powers to investigate our personal lives, because that's a good idea. We want the military to defend our country. So I think we have to start having these conversations. I don't have answers, but these are tough questions. And I'd like it if the government can demonstrate that they are deserving of the trust they expect us to give them. I think we'd be willing to give it to them again if they acted like they should, that they deserved it. And this is hard.
You know, I would just say, like, you know, I have friends who could be making a lot more money doing a lot more different, you know, things, but they work inside our government, whether they're working for intelligence community or they're working for 18F or like the census, I mean, for NAIDN, you know, so there's a lot of pathways for us. And, you know, I find that, you know, Jeff Bezos said something like, you know, the day that the tech firms turn their back on the military is not like a good day, right? So explaining why Amazon works in the military. And I feel like, you know, it's not for civilians to be building this stuff. It's for people to do what you did, KK, and say, look, I want to be there to help advise other, you know, people in the armed forces with me, right? I want to be there to be that voice that understands this stuff. And there are many people, women and men like you, who will follow, right? So I say, when the government is looking to the tech firms to solve computational problems, we're in a bad place. Because in the past, there was a pathway of people working in government doing amazing things with computers, and that's where tech firms maybe took the lead from, right? Or took some ideas from, or took some humans from to work, right? So, but you know, like Bruce has said, like, we ended up in this place where trust is misplaced, and you know, there are examples of things being used where civilians have been contracted to make things for military use, and I feel like it doesn't really work well. I think it creates reputational damage and confusion for the private sector. Like, you look at napalm and Dow, and so I feel like what we need is a military that's like, look, we're gonna bring in and attract the best and brightest. We're gonna work with you to give you access to amazing tools and have you build our HoloLens, right? So I think that's the, and it's something that could be probably like better trusted, and you won't have people saying, I didn't sign up to do this. It's actually, I did sign up to do this.
Just one last thing that I heard you say, echo chamber, and so that to me signals that it's an isolating proposition, and that if there's not more communication across the sectors, regardless of your title or role, or you know, that then the proclivity for that imbalance to become even greater in terms of not only use but invention and intention, that's dangerous unto itself. And so it seems like before anybody's jumping to work one place or another, that dialogue at the very least is really important. That's something that I heard you say.
Hi, thanks for being here. My name is Marta. I work in the civil society policy space. Basically, we're looking at growing autonomy and weapon systems and the human rights implications of that. And so my question to you is, a lot of these big tech companies now have ethical AI principles, they have acceptable use policies, codes of conduct. Do you think those are enough? And how are smaller companies or startups tackling these same challenges? What's the role of the CEO or the founder, maybe when there's not a team of 25 ethicists behind them?
I mean, thank you for the work that you do, by the way, Marta. So I would say, for me, I look at those questions, and I'm like, not for killer robots. I mean, I watch Terminator like the rest of you, right? So no more killer robots, right? And we have these pledges. We have these open letters. I remember like when thousands of people signed, like, I will not use my AI skills for bad. But if a code of conduct is only as good as its last use, and if it's never been used, something's wrong. I want to see transparency reports on a lot of these norms. So if it's like, we actually can't tell you what the project was, but we stopped 50 projects out of the 60 that we were gonna, you know, were planning because of our ethicist or because of our conversations in-house on things. Because it's just a piece of paper. It's just letters if you haven't actually used it. If you haven't enforced rules, people haven't lost their job, people haven't, you know, so I feel like that's the strength of a code of conduct. That's the strength of any kind of documenting principles. It's not easy to do that. And when you're a smaller company, whether you're a larger company, it's the same. I also say if you're spending $15 when you make 10, you're going to spend 15 million when you make 10 million. So if you're a small company and you're not doing something along those paths of saying like, what can this product do that's harmful? You know, we might just be five people in a lunchroom trying to figure this out, but the fact that we have this conversation and we take it seriously means that we always will have this conversation and we'll always take it seriously.
So I like seeing codes of conduct, ethical principles, I mean, and around AI and ethics, there's got to be dozens at this point. It seems like every organization is coming up with their list of principles and things we should and shouldn't do. I mean, as long as they're voluntary, they're going to be voluntary. We have to deal with non-compliant actors. I mean, like, approach this as an information security problem. We know how to do this. And we have a set of principles. And what do we do with people who don't follow them? How do we detect them? How do we prevent it from spreading? How do we mitigate what harm they do? So we have to approach this with all the security tools that we have developed in the couple of decades we've been doing this work. And apply it to these new areas and new technologies. Now, I like seeing principles of ethical use of AI. I worry about the people who won't read them and won't follow them. They will exist. Right? You know, we know how technology works. It's democratized. What is hard today becomes easy in 2 years. And then 2 years later, it's a high school science project. And now I have a serious problem that I really didn't have in the last century with things like nuclear power. I'm going to have it with AI. I'm going to have it with biotech. I'm going to have it with autonomy, robotics. I mean, these are going to be the problems of technology in this century. So, and we need to solve them. And principles are a nice start, and it tells us where we want to go. But getting to those principles where society follows them and they're enforced, we as an industry may be called on to do that.
Hi there. Thanks for your time today.
Sorry, we only have 5 minutes, so okay. Everyone, double your question speed. Sorry, go on.
I'll make this quick. So I'm Joe. I'm sort of representing the humanitarian sector. I'm with the Do No Digital Harm Initiative. Matt invited me here today, so thanks for that. This is my first RSA. So my question, so I'm inspired by like the idea that we need to have awareness around this and individual kind of entry points for action. I want to encourage the panelists and also everybody in this room to think about moving from individual awareness to some kind of coordinated action, right? Because I'm going to just quickly make the case that a little bit of goodwill here and there actually isn't enough. First is that in the humanitarian sector, the sort of scope, the urgency, the implications of these conversations is almost crippling to have. And you can think about the conflict in Syria, you can think about Ebola response, you can think about Nepal earthquake, or a place where we were just working in Myanmar, whereby, affected populations really do rely critically on information systems and digital services. Think about digital cash transfers, think about mobile connectivity hubs, think about electronic ID and things like that, and they're really vulnerable. And then the second is, we talked about the window might be closing. I think the window's closed. And if you want to, I mean, you can just look at the case of Myanmar. 700,000 displaced people as a result of digital hate speech and coordinated disinformation campaigns, who, by the way, 700,000 is a figure only within 6 months, moving from Myanmar to Bangladesh. And also, by the way, are requiring on their mobile phones to access humanitarian assistance. So with that kind of urgency, I'm just wondering what you think about mechanisms, platforms, to move from basic wokeness to let's get some well-resourced and coordinated action on this, because this is RSA, right? So let's think in the next couple of days about how we can pull some resources to this issue.
Let's move into the performance art portion of this. So we have 5 minutes left. So I'm going to ask us to really speed. Thank you for your question. Speed through so your questions are in the room, and then we can respond to anything that we hear. Please. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, so.
But quickly, please.
Jason Strait, I'm a chief privacy officer at United Lex. And I happen to think that lack of transparency, you mentioned it, Matt, is one of the biggest problems we have. I mean, there's a reason that senators don't understand how Facebook makes money. Facebook doesn't make it that clear how they make money. And so, and I also think that that ability to operate in the shadows allows companies, I don't think there's very many companies who set out to be evil and to do bad things. Mm-hmm. They drift in that direction because they're like, hey, nobody minded that last step, I'm going to take another. And they find themselves there. So the question is, and I think it also, that's what that dissonance between what companies say they're doing, what they're actually doing, lets employees off the hook. Because even if they feel kind of crummy about what they did at work that day, they go to a party and it's like, oh, you're at Facebook, that's so awesome, right? So how do we address that transparency problem? Is it, you know, GDPR for all? You know, I actually have grown kind of fond of that mm-hmm. piece of legislation. Or is it activism? You know, how do we get these companies to be more transparent?
Okay. Thank you, Jason. My answer is that it's both, real quick.
I'd agree. I think that's a great comment, though. Is
okay.
Quickly, Brian Wright, I'm a former lawyer and law prof. Just to echo everything Matt said, it'd be nice to hear from you guys what you think the action items are that could come out of this great day. Mm-hmm. And then I would add two suggestions. One is there is a lot of stuff that's going on that I don't think is completely coordinated. IEEE has a lot going on. I mean, you've got EFF coming up. So an aggregation of that stuff might be interesting. And then adding to Bruce's list, sort of thinking about at the local government level how technologists can advise on the acquisition, deployment, and procurement of, I think there's real need there. We do a lot of work with them. So thanks.
Thank you.
I agree that state and local governments are a place to really have to look, especially as the federal government abdicates its regulatory responsibility. Mm-hmm. California especially, New York, Massachusetts, other
yeah.
states.
Yeah, and meet us in the hallway for more action items later.
Yes.
And sure. cookies.
I'll be quite quick. My name is Beatrice. I'm a nuclear robotics engineer who went to law school. Came up at a time when I was really inspired by Don't Be Evil in Google's mission statement. Practiced law for a while, realized there's a million shades of gray. Mm-hmm. And I love my tech community. I come from a family of technologists, and they are my people. But we perhaps are not as well equipped as some of our liberal arts friends who spent a lot of time really, you know, studying that stuff to answer these questions, and now we're coming together. It's exciting. So like many in this room, and certainly the panel, I've been doing a lot of reading and thinking and reading and thinking. A question keeps coming to my mind, and I'd love to know what you think, and anyone else in the room. To me, the question is, how do we incentivize good behavior in the market? And mm-hmm. I mean economically. Mm-hmm. Because before Al Gore, for me, before Al Gore, we didn't have a burgeoning economy mm-hmm. of green technologies. It wasn't cool yeah. at that time, but now it's profitable. So that's my question.
We're at time. I'm sorry.
That's okay. That's my question.
Yeah. Thank you, Beatrice. And the answer is waiting for you in the hallway with a cookie.
Yeah. And I'm sorry that we can't get to your
Thank you all. Come back in half an hour, I think, for the next panel. Yeah.
Thank you.